Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a message from one of our special guests.
This is probably the most unspiritual message that you're ever going to hear from me because it's just simply called practical Christianity. And it's a very, very bizarre text that we're going to use, very different text. I don't know if you've ever had a sermon out of this text. But I believe there's some tremendous lessons that will help all of us. The context of the main scripture we're going to look at is the fact that David had committed adultery and had actually murdered one of his best friends, one of his top soldiers, a man by the name of Uriah the Hittite. And David had slept with his wife and gotten her pregnant, and then he tried to cover it up. And anyway, the husband would not sleep with his wife, and so he had him murdered. And then when he was murdered, took the wife and took his wife as his own. And God confronts him. And God says, because of what you've done, there's going to be tremendous shame. And this child that's going to be born is going to be, you know, everybody in the world's going to know what's happened. And it's going to bring shame to my name. And we pick up the story now as God has spoken that the child is going to die and that the child, and that there's that judgment will be upon that. But God has also, in the same breath, he's given mercy to David. And he's given mercy to his life. And God says, you know, I've forgiven you. But this child's not going to make it through this situation. And we pick this up in 2 Samuel chapter 12 as we finish up the story of what now happens to David and how David now navigates the birth of this child and the subsequent events that take place. 2 Samuel chapter 12 and verse 13, it says, David says, "Then David confessed to Nathan, 'I have sinned against the Lord.' Nathan replied, 'Yes, but the Lord has forgiven you, and you won't die for this sin. Nevertheless, because you've shown utter contempt for the word of the Lord by doing this, your child will die.'" Verse 15, "Now after Nathan returned to his home, the Lord sent a deadly illness to the child of David and Uriah's wife. David begged God to spare the child. He went without food and lay all night on the bare ground. The elders of his household pleaded with him to get up and eat with them, but he refused. He did this for 7 days, and then on the seventh day, the child died. David's advisors were afraid to tell him. He wouldn't listen to reason while the child was ill. They said, 'What drastic thing will he do when we tell him the child is dead?' Then David got up from the ground." It says, "When David saw them whispering," in verse 19, "he realized what had happened. 'Is the child dead?' he asked. 'Yes,' they replied, 'he is dead.'" In verse 20, "Then David got up from the ground, washed himself. He put on lotions and changed his clothes. He went to the tabernacle and worshiped the Lord. After that, he returned to the palace and was served food and ate. His advisors were amazed. 'We don't understand you,' they told him. 'While the child was living, you wept and refused to eat. Now that the child's dead, you've stopped your mourning and you're eating again.' David replied, 'I fasted and wept while the child was alive. For I said, perhaps the Lord will be gracious to me and let the child live. But why should I fast when he's dead? Can I bring him back again? I will go to him one day, but he cannot return to me.' Then David comforted Bathsheba, his wife, and slept with her. She became pregnant and gave birth to a son, and David named him Solomon. The Lord loved the child. And he sent word through Nathan the prophet that they should name him Jedidah, or Jedidiah, which means beloved of the Lord, as the Lord had commanded." We see David now faced with a situation that really arose because of his own sin. It wasn't just a situation that, you know, just a natural situation, but, you know, many times we are confronted with very difficult trials. There's not a single person in this place that's not going to go through. You've either gone through or in the midst of, or you will go through situations that are very, very difficult. That are very a difficult one to understand. There's maybe a life hanging in the balance, maybe a child, maybe a marriage, maybe a business, maybe your finances, whatever it is. We're going to face situations that are extremely difficult. And David here is now confronted with a situation that is the result of his sin. And many times, maybe we have had situations in our lives that may be a result of something we did in the past. Maybe we took drugs, or we did something and we messed something up, or maybe we messed up our finances, or messed up our, you know, our credit record, or maybe we even messed up and created a criminal record, or whatever a situation was. All of us have stuff that we are carrying, and we're going to face a circumstance that's very difficult. Amen? And we see here that there's a window that David had. It was about a window of 7 days. Between the time when he knew he'd messed up, he knew that the likelihood was that the child would probably die, but David, the child was still alive. And David had a window. And we all, I think, many times, and in fact, we don't always have that opportunity. Sometimes something hits us and we don't even have a chance to pray. But many, many times, there is this window that we have the ability to be able to press into a situation. And David's response is 100% to seek God. David's response is 100% to fast, to pray, to cry out for the mercy of God. And I believe that that's our foundation bedrock of any circumstance that we face. Our number one person we go to is God. Our number one foundation of our lives is to say, God, you know, we messed up, this happened, whatever, but God, I trust in you. I'm trusting in your mercy. I'm trusting in your grace. And we go to him. Our first response must always be spiritual. Amen? Amen. Because God is our source. He's our life. But I'm going to say this, that we're not going to win every battle. We're not going to win every battle. We may win some, and we may lose some. When I worked for Reinhard Bonnke, I was his television producer, and they were working in Africa, and there was a man there who had a tremendous ministry of praying for the dead to rise again. And the people were interviewing him and said, you know, you've had 5 people raised from the dead through your ministry. What's your secret? What do you do that's just amazing? Well, how can God use you to raise the dead? You know what his answer was? He says, if you'd prayed for as many dead people as I've prayed for, you'd also see a few of them raised from the dead. You see, every opportunity he could, and every time he prayed for a dead person, he learned a little bit more about, you know, and when he saw success, I mean, it was something that he was growing in. But there are battles we're going to win, and there's battles we're not going to win. And this was a battle that David really fought valiantly. He really cried out to God. He really prayed. And the child dies. Now, let me just give you a contrast in the New Testament. In the New Testament, you have a situation where the disciples are, in the book of Acts, are expanding the church. Everything is growing. And King Herod takes the disciple James, the brother of John, and he literally captures him and murders him on the spot. The church doesn't even have a chance to pray, doesn't have a chance to do anything. And the Bible says it pleased the Jews so much that he immediately grabbed a hold of Peter, but instead of killing Peter immediately, he puts him in prison. And the church has a window of time to pray. And what happens is that the church begins to pray for Peter, and they intercede and they cry out to God. And that window of opportunity, when God gives it, we need to seize it. We need to go in after God. We need to pray. We need to give everything we can to see God move and God do a miracle. Amen? And Peter didn't die because the church prayed. If you know the story, that God sends an angel in the night, and he walks out of the prison completely free. Because the church had an opportunity to take advantage of a window that God gave. So that's why my wife's, you know, strong on Facebook. And she just, every day, we connect with our friends and family and partners and people because we want to be a part of their lives. We know that if any one of us gets attacked, I mean, immediately we put out that call for prayer. We can get 200-300 people praying, and God so often comes through with a miracle. But there are situations like this with David where he didn't win the battle. And so our first response is spiritual and going to God and trusting and taking advantage of that window that God gives us. We must always seek God, always trust Him, always pray for mercy, for the miraculous intervention and for God's help. But then what happens is, in verse 18, it says this, and we can put it back up. It says, on the seventh day the child died. David's advisors were afraid to tell him. He wouldn't listen to reason. While the child was ill, they said, what drastic thing will he do when we tell him the child's dead? Many times we as Christians, when we lose a battle, that's when we fall apart. That's when we just give up. That's when we just, you know, oh, well, you know, I mean, we often lose our faith. We often go, you know, into complete, that's when we start mourning. And that's when we go into, you know, in extreme measures. But David doesn't do that. You see, David has a very pragmatic and a very realistic evaluation of what's happening here. He knows that that child's going to be with God, and he knows that that child's going to be in the hands of the Lord. He knows that he can't bring the child back, and he knows that he messed up, and he knows that, you know, all of those things, that God is merciful. He doesn't lose his trust in God's goodness or God's mercy or God's anything. He fights and he humbles himself and he prays while he has an opportunity. But when it ends and when he knows he can't do anything to change it, the Bible says the following. He says in verse 19, David saw them whispering. He realized what happened. Is the child dead? He asked. Yes, they replied, he's dead. David got up from the ground, washed himself, put on lotions, changed his clothes. He went to the tabernacle, he worshiped the Lord. After that, he returned to the palace and was served food and ate. See, there is a moment and a time when we've got to, you know what? You have to fire the past as the director of your future. You cannot have your past be the person who's dictating what happens in the future. You've got to realize, all right, I can't change the past. I can't change what's happened. I can't change, but I can from now on. I can, you know, pick myself up from the ground. I need to wash myself off. I need to, you know, put on some lotions, put on some cologne, you know, get yourself looking decent and go and worship God at the rock and then go home and eat a good meal. Amen. We've got to learn to be pragmatic. We've got to learn to be realistic. And David, you know, when they ask him and they say, this doesn't make any sense because you're supposed to go into mourning and then now 40 days and then you weep and cry and then you're a basket case for 3 years and, you know, you can't get over it. No, we just got to go on because they're in the hands of God and we have to still live and we've got to finish our race. Amen. And so we see this very pragmatic response of David. You know, we have a person that's running for president, and his name is Dr. Ben Carson. He's declared his presidency, I think, in May. And he's amazing, one of my heroes, just his story, his life story. He has a movie out and a book called Gifted Hands that tells the life history of Dr. Ben Carson. And the thing I like so much about his story was just how pragmatic and how practical. Because his mother, those of you who may not know the story, his mother gave birth to his brother when she was 13, gave birth to him when she was 15, so was a teenager raising two children on the streets of Detroit. As a young African-American child, I mean, he got into all kinds of trouble, and his mom was trying to work 2, 3, 4 jobs. I think when his mom was about 20, she got fully born again, gave her heart to the Lord and said, God, I cannot raise these kids alone. Let me tell you, coming to a relationship with God, that's the basis and the foundation of everything in your future. And as difficult as her world was, and the man had left and gone, I think, up to Boston, and so she was raising alone two kids who were running about 3 jobs at the time and crying out to God. And when the children were, I think, were in about the 5th grade and the 3rd grade, they brought their you know, report card home to their mother. And she looked down the report card and all it read was F, 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 every single subject. fact, the kids were at the bottom of the class. They had no, I mean, they were absolutely the most horrendous students in the school. And she said to her kids, she said, you know what? I'm going to go and seek God. I'm going to get a plan from him. And whatever God says, we're going to do it. And the kids were like, whatever. You know, they were like, they had a bit of an attitude, or a lot of an attitude. And she came back after 3 days, and God showed her to do three things. And they were just extremely practical things. And the three things were, you're not going to go and play with your friends until you finish your homework. Number two, you're only going to watch 2 hours of television a week. And she said, I'm going to help choose those hours and what's going to be watched. And number three, she said, we're going down to the library. We're going to choose two books. You're going to read two books and write a book report each week on these two books. Up until that time, the kids had never read a full book in their whole lives. Kids are like, what? This is crazy. And they complained, and she said, I don't care. That's what God showed me. It was a very practical thing to do. She didn't tell them that she couldn't read. So even reading the book report, she just put red marks on things, and she would just pretend to. But you know what? In 9 months, the kids went from the bottom of the class to the top of the class. Amen. And her son, Ben Carson, graduated with a full scholarship to the University of Michigan, where I met my wife, Lisa. And then he got a scholarship into medical school. At the age of 33, he became the head of neurosurgery at Johns Hopkins University, the youngest person ever to take that position. He was involved in a 27-hour operation of separating Siamese twins in Germany. Became one of the most famous surgeons that's ever lived on the planet. Going back to a mother who got a practical solution that God gave her. We sometimes think that because it's, you know, it's got to be spiritual, like an angel's got to appear and then, you know, wave some, you know, magic fairy dust over something. You know, it's often our solution in the things of God is very pragmatic and practical things that God makes us do. Are you with me, church? And so, in many, many ways, I really believe that we have to take a very realistic. And so my second point is that we must make a realistic evaluation. And David looked at a situation and he said, this is what's happening. This is where it is. I can't change it. He says, I'm making an evaluation. He says, now's the time. I can't fast anymore. It's not going to make any bit of difference. He said, now I'm going to pick up myself up. I'm going to, you know, worship God. I'm going to eat a good meal and I'm going to go forward. And God now brought him to point number three, which we must make practical and not emotional plans. The Bible says in verse 24, then David comforted Bathsheba, his wife, and he slept with her. She became pregnant and gave birth to a son. And David named him Solomon. The Lord loved the child. The redemption of the story of David and Bathsheba is the birth of a child by the name of Solomon, the wisest human being that ever lived on the entire planet. A child that God loved greatly. And God brought redemption through through God bringing a child into the union and a child that was blessed of God and a child that had God's grace upon him. And that was, you know, out of this tremendous sin that David committed, God is able to redeem even the worst situations. And that comes through a pragmatic and practical area because he went on, he married her, and you know what? They went and began a family, and the first child that was born became the next king of Israel in the lineage of Jesus Christ. God brought forth redemption through that child. Amen? So many times when things happen and go wrong, people get stuck. They get bogged down. They get, well, I don't understand why God didn't do this or why God didn't do that. You know what? There's going to be lots of time, like all eternity, to answer all the questions as to why. We're not going to get them on this side. The Bible says we see through a glass darkly. What we can do is we know God's goodness, we know His faithfulness, we know His love, we know His mercy, is that we have to go forward and keep, you know, moving on with what God has. A famous missionary by the name of David Livingstone, I'm sure you've all heard of him. And he made this statement, just a wonderful statement. He said these words. He said, I'll go anywhere so long as it's forward. Amen? It's pretty profound. He says, I'll go anywhere so long as it's forward. We've got to go forward, church. We can't be stuck in anything that happens. We can't be stuck by a circumstance. We can't be stuck by a bankruptcy. We can't be stuck by a divorce. We can't be stuck by whatever has happened in our lives that wants to hold us back. We cannot let that stuck us. Are you with me? When I was just preparing, we were going to throw up a picture of a guy by the name of W. Mitchell. Amazing, amazing, amazing story. And W. Mitchell, you see that he's got almost no hands there. His fingers are all burned off. And his face, he had 16 skin graft surgeries on his body to try and... But let me just give you a little bit of background about this man. He lives in Butte, Montana. And W. Mitchell, at the age of 28, this was in the early 70s, he was a Marine. He had come out of the Marine Corps, but he was in incredible shape, and he was just had everything going for him in his life. When he purchased a brand new motorcycle, on the second day that he was riding this motorcycle, it crashed into the back of another vehicle, and all of the gasoline just poured out over him and ignited and burned 65% of his entire body. Burned all his fingers off, burned his face, almost completely unrecognizable, and pretty much almost incinerated him. And somehow he bounced back from that, was able to get his life back even without his hands. And, you know, about 4 years later when he started to fly airplanes and he started to, you know, do other things and begin his life back. And he thought, oh, you know, at least he had use of his body and he was able to just, you know, keep going. 4 years later, when he was piloting a plane, he crashed the plane and became paralyzed from the waist down. Well, following that, he refused to let his circumstances stop what he would do with his life. He refused to do that. After that, he became the founding chairman of a $65 million company. He became a two-term mayor. He became a congressional nominee. He became a radio host, a television personality. He became a published author. He got into the Speakers Hall of Fame, and he's spoken in over 30 countries, and he's been invited to the White House under 5 U.S. presidents. And they said to him, like, how did you do this? I mean, you've got no hands, and you basically, your face, you know, looks like he actually ran his campaign, you know, not just another pretty face. You know what our politicians look like. And basically, his message is, it's not what happens to you, it's what you do about it. And he says these words, he says, before I was paralyzed, he says, there were 10,000 things I could do. He says, now there's 9,000. I can either dwell on the 1,000 I've lost or focus on the 9,000 I have left. Yeah. Amen? You know, it's so much of how we look at things. And I believe God's calling us as the church to pragmatic, practical Christianity. To evaluate honestly where we're at, what we've got, what we can do, what we can't do. And to, you know, pick up the pieces and say, God, you know, with what I got, I'm going to do the most and I'm going to make the most impact. But most of us wallow in what we don't have as opposed to focusing on what we do have. Yeah. Amen? Yeah. A friend of mine, two weekends ago, I was ministering in Pennsylvania, and a friend drove up from Washington, D.C., and very conservative man, and he normally doesn't, you know, he wouldn't gravitate towards Joyce Meyer. But, you know, as we were talking about, he says, you know, that Joyce Meyer, he says, I really like her ministry. And I was really surprised because, you know, normally he wouldn't even like a woman in ministry. And I said, why? Why is it that you're saying that? And he said, you know, he said, that woman has so much common sense. You know what? God's actually looking for a lot of common sense. there's a lot of things we can just do. You don't have to get a word from heaven. You don't have to have, like, you know, an angel visit you. You just have to have some common sense. Get up and do something. Amen? I heard of a father who took his child out on a fishing boat, and he's trying to teach his child a lesson. And he took him on a rowboat, and on the one oar, he wrote the word prayer. And on the other oar, he wrote the word work. And he said to his kid, okay, we're just going to row with this one. And all they did was go around in circles. He said, oh, well, we can work with this one. We just row with this one. He said to the kid, you have to row with both prayer and work. You've got to have a balance, and only then will you go forward and or you go backwards, whichever way you're going. Amen? Many times ministers come to Pastor Jim, and many times I've, you know, been a part of just seeing this happen where ministries or pastors or maybe somebody who's, you know, gone into the ministry and maybe they're struggling, and maybe they have a great ministry. It can be an incredible ministry, maybe a new church plant or something. And they come to Pastor Jim and say, oh, God called me into the ministry, Pastor Jim. And, you know, we're just not making ends meet. We're not getting there. And I'm somehow, you know, our church is going down, down, down. And can you give me some advice? Pastor Jim's advice is always three words long. Get a job. Amen. But sometimes people, like, that's the last thing they think about. Guy who wrote most of this New Testament Bible, he made tents. And sometimes whatever it takes, when Lisa and I started the ministry, we had 5 jobs between us. And if we have to, we'll go back and get another 5. Amen? I just want to point out to you that Matthew chapter 25, it's your homework tonight, just write down Matthew 25. Matthew 25 has this incredible, it's got 3 major parables that come through this chapter. Jesus speaking about the end times. He's speaking about the judgment and what we're supposed to do. The first parable is the parable of the oil and the lamp. Oil in the lamp, it's the 10 virgins. It's not 5 virgins and 5 harlots, it's 10 virgins. 10 Christians. 5 trouble themselves to get oil in their lamp. 5 trouble themselves to come on a Wednesday night and get the word of God. Amen? You guys are the wise ones. We need the anointing of God. We need to allow that word to prepare us for his coming. There's no shortcut to that. Second parable deals with, you know, using the talents that God gives us, both the resources and also the gifts and the abilities and the things that he gives us every day. That's the second parable that God, you know, judges us to. But the third parable is what's called the sheep and the goats. And the Bible says that Jesus is going to be in the final judgment, and he's going to separate the nations, and there's going to be sheep and goats. And we're picking up the story of what Jesus says to the sheep, which I believe is all of us. Amen? In verse 31 of Matthew 25, when the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the holy angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory, and all the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate them one from another, as a shepherd divides his sheep from the goats. He will set the sheep on his right hand and the goats on the left. The king will say to those on his right hand, come, you blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. He says in verse 35, I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty, you gave me drink. I was a stranger, you took me in. I was naked and you clothed me. I was sick and you visited me. I was in prison and you came to me. Now, I want to just take a look at that list. Not one time does he say you were in church and I was, you know, it doesn't say you read your Bible. It doesn't say you fasted. It doesn't say, you know, you worshiped. It doesn't say anything about, you know, there's nothing spiritual in there. Every single one of them. I was hungry, you fed me. I was in prison, you visited me. I mean, I was sick and you came to me. I was naked, you clothed me. And I look at that list and I'm saying, the inheritance for all eternity is being handed out here based on a bunch of really pragmatic, practical things that people do. In fact, they're so practical that the saints who get this reward, they don't even know they did them. They just did them. I think sometimes we just need to get the The hardened eyes and the heart of a mother. Because mothers just do this stuff, you know. It's just like, if their kid comes, I mean, whatever the need is, they'll take care of it. Verse 37. The righteous will answer, saying, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you drink? When did we see you a stranger and take you in, or naked and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and come to you? And the king will answer and say to them, assuredly I say to you, inasmuch as you did it to one of the least of these, my brethren, you did it to me. I'm so proud to be a part of this church that feeds the poor and goes into the convalescent homes and does what it does. Amen? Because at the end of the day, practical Christianity to me is worth more than all of those, you know, Holy Spirit, you know, running around or whatever people do. And praise God for people who have, you know, wonderful spiritual experiences. But let me tell you, when the judgment comes, it's practical Christianity that's going to determine your eternal reward. Amen? And so we need to move forward and we need to be pragmatic and make, and we mustn't be led by emotion. So many Christians, they will just be led by their emotions. They make an emotional decision. Emotional decision about, you know, the future spouse. An emotional decision about, you know, it could be any number of areas. A purchase that they shouldn't make. When I was with Reinhard, he always used to say, you know, if you want to hear from the Lord, he said you need to neutralize your desires. Neutralize your emotions. Because your emotions will always draw you in all different directions. You want to hear from God, you've got to put those emotions aside and say, Lord, what's your will? You want to pray and get a pragmatic and you get a word from the Lord that's got wisdom and realism and truth behind it. Amen? So my final point is, let's be creative in how we move forward. Let's be creative in how we move forward. You see, sometimes we will be restricted by maybe our age, maybe our education, maybe it may be a physical disability, it may be a financial disability, it may be whatever. There's so many barriers to what we want to do in our lives. And sometimes even God will put up some barriers. I really love the Freedom for Our Future campaign that the church has been running here. As a member, as a part of this church, under the covering of this church, it's an honor for me to be a part of it. It's an honor for me to have a part in building the kingdom of God and building the house of God. Because I know what good this church does, and I know the hearts of the leaders of this church, and I have known it for, you know, 25 years that I've seen the heart of this church, and I'm so honored to be a part of sowing into it. Amen. Freedom for Our Future is just an amazing thing, because I always contrast it with King David. See, David loved God with such an amazing love. And David wanted to build the house of God. He wanted to be the king that would establish his kingdom, and he wanted to take that tent, that tabernacle that had come through the wilderness that was pretty worn 400 years later. And David wanted to be the one. In fact, he brought it to Jerusalem and he worshiped it in that tabernacle, the tabernacle of David. And David wanted to build a house for God. He wanted the honor and privilege of doing what we're doing here, of establishing and building a house for God's name in the Inland Empire. David wanted to build it in Jerusalem. And Nathan said, you know, go ahead and do whatever you want to do. But in the night, God came to Nathan and said, you go back and speak to David and tell David he's not allowed to. Tell David, you've shed too much blood on the earth. You will not build me a house. You are not allowed to build me a house. I refuse to let you build a house. God put a line in the sand and said to David, you may not do this. Now, to me, I look at that as the same as many other restrictions we have in our lives. It can be a physical handicap. It can be anything. It can be a financial hardship. It can be anything that we can't do it because of a circumstance, situation, or wherever we're at. But you know, David looked at that and said, okay, I'm not allowed to build the house. But he didn't say anything about preparing to build a house. And God didn't say anything about me getting the blueprint and the plans for the house. And God didn't say anything about me, you know, getting the gold for the inside of the house and getting the silver that would be on the floor of the house. And God didn't say anything about me arranging for the timber to come to build the house. I'm going to do everything else that I can with what I got. Amen? See, there may be a restriction on you, but you, it doesn't stop you from doing everything possible that you can outside of the restriction. Are you with me, church? In 1 Chronicles chapter 29, David writes, this is the closing words of King David. Listen to these words. He says, using every resource at my command, I have gathered as much as I could for building the temple of my God. Now there is enough gold, silver, bronze, iron, and wood, as well as great quantities of onyx and other precious stones, costly jewels, and all kinds of fine stones and marble. And now, because of my devotion to the temple of my God, I am giving all of my own private treasures of gold and silver to help in the construction. This is in addition to the building materials I've already collected for this holy temple. I'm donating more than 112 tons of gold from Ophir and 262 tons of refined silver. My goodness. I mean, God said you can't build the house, but I mean, David did just everything but build the house. I mean, all Solomon had to do was like grab the pieces and put them together and just, you know, there was the house because David already prepared everything. And so my heart is like, I look at, you know, even the situations, we've got laws being passed that, you know what, okay, we've got the laws, so what can we do outside of those laws? What can we do that we're still allowed to do? What can we do that we, you know, there's situations happening around the world, there's countries that are open and closed, well, that country is closed, well, how about the 400, or the, I guess there's only 192, whatever, but what about the other 150 that are open? You can still get them. My heart is that we start to think creatively about what we can do, of what we do have, what opportunities are there. And we can always either dwell on what we don't have or we can work on what we do have. And David said, I put every single resource at my command. I used it to attack this job. And I just love the heart of David. And I just really felt like God tonight wanted just to speak into many lives here. And say, look, you may have messed up like David did, but God can bring a Solomon out of that. God can bring out of whatever, you know, problem you had. You can't allow the enemy to keep you in that place. You've got to pick up yourself. You've got to wash yourself off. You've got to go to the house of God. You've got to worship God. You've got to move forward and then take a good meal and go forward and do what God's called you to do. And let's look at what we can do, not what we can't. Let's be pragmatic. Let's be practical. And you know what? I every single day, you know, I run our ministry and my heart is, I mean, I'm spiritual. I mean, I get up, I take time in prayer before God. The first half an hour of our ministry time, it cost me thousands of dollars a week. Every weekday from 8:30 to 9, we pray as a team. I mean, I believe in all of that, and I believe we have to be, you know, in the spirit, and we've got to be trusting God, and we've got to put God first. I believe in all of that. But 9 o'clock comes. We got to work hard. We've prayed, now we work. Now we pick up the pieces. Now we go forward. Now we have to, you know, call, and now we have to, you know, get the word of God out to nations, and now we have to translate languages, and we've got to get up and do what God's called us to do. And when you put those two together, when you put the spiritual and you keep God in that place, but then you pick up the pieces and you work hard, the combination of that is so powerful. That's real Christianity. That's true Christianity. Nothing's below our dignity. Nothing's below what we can and shouldn't do. And we should be practical and go forward and get creative solutions from God to the problems of our families and of our businesses and of our world in Jesus' name. If God spoke to you, give the Lord a hand. Amen. I just want to make sure that everybody's okay here with God. You know, we take salvation for granted because sometimes, you know, well, it's available, and you often hear an appeal person says, you know, you need to give your heart to Jesus Christ, you need to get saved. You actually have a window. You have an opportunity, but the moment that that door closes, there's a story in Luke 16 of a man who's in hell, and he's there for eternity, and he's in torment. And he says to Abraham, please send Lazarus back, and I've got five brothers, and I want them coming here. He has cognizance of his family, his cognizance, and you know, while he was on the earth, he had a chance to have eternal life, but he didn't take it. And you think that that's always going to be there. It's not. The moment you die, that opportunity is taken from you. You don't have it anymore. And I was reading through in Acts chapter 11 recently, when the Jews only thought that the Jews were the only people that could get saved. When after Jesus rose from the dead, they thought that this message of salvation was only for the Jews. God orchestrated a whole bunch of things in Acts chapter 11, and Peter goes into a house, and Cornelius and his whole household receive the Holy Spirit, and they all get saved. And they go back, and the Jews are like, why did you go to that guy's house? And, you know, at the end of that whole situation, the Jews make this statement, and it's an incredible statement. In Acts chapter 11, verse 18, it says here, they said, we can see that God has also given the Gentiles the privilege of repenting of their sins and receiving eternal life. I thought, my goodness, we have the privilege of repenting. We have the opportunity, the privilege to repent of our sins and receive a gift from God of eternal life. We only have it for a short time. When I was with Reinhard, he always used to describe it like this. He said, you know, if you have a bright light, and if you walk away from that light, where's the shadow going to be? It's going to always be in front of you because you're walking away from the light. He says, there's only one way to fix the problem. It's not because you can run away from the light. You can jog, you can do whatever. Whatever way you go, if you're walking away from the light, you're always walking into darkness. You're going to walk into your shadow. And there's only one way to fix the problem of walking into darkness. You've got to turn. You've got to repent. You've got to turn around and you've got to face the light. And you've got to start to walk towards the light. And that is what we do. We have the privilege of repenting, the privilege of turning, the privilege, if we're going the wrong way, to turn towards God and walk towards Him. Because when you walk towards the light, there's no shadow. The shadow is always going to be behind you. The darkness will always be behind you. Your way is going to be illuminated because you're walking towards the light. The Bible says that Jesus is the light of the world. And we have the privilege to repent, to turn away from the sins that we're living, the way that we're going. We have to turn away from them and turn towards the Lord. Well, I'd like all of your eyes just close for a moment. And if you tonight need to turn, and you tonight need to turn towards Jesus and turn away from whatever direction you've been going, any sin that you have been walking into and that you have been committing and living in. And tonight you know that God's speaking to you, and He's calling you tonight to turn away from darkness. He's calling you to turn your life towards Him and give your life to Jesus Christ tonight. Make Him Lord of your life. God's giving you an opportunity. You may not have this opportunity because I know of people in Africa when we had crusades, one man who was 28 years old, he turned around, he gave his heart to the Lord, he walked 9 paces and died, 28 years old. You don't have guarantee of tomorrow. The Bible says today's the day of salvation, and today's the day that you must make a decision because you're not guaranteed any other day. Now is the time, the Bible says. And I want to have the opportunity of praying for anybody who tonight needs to turn. Needs to turn away from sin, turn away from walking into darkness in their lives, and turn their life to God and give their life to Jesus Christ. And if you want me to pray for you to do that, wherever you are, I just want you just to raise up your hand wherever you are. If you need me to pray with you, I see your hand. Anybody else that needs to do that tonight? Needs to turn to God. Is there anybody else? I see your hand there. Anybody else that needs to do that? Another hand over there. Anybody else? Just raise up and just wave it at me if you need to make that decision tonight. A handful of people. Anybody else? Yes, I see your hand. God bless you. Anybody else that needs to do that? God's presence is here. The Holy Spirit is knocking at the door of your heart. You don't have this. I see your hand there. God bless you. Anybody else that needs to do this? Anybody else? Holy Spirit's prompting you. Now's the time of salvation. Now's the time to change. Now's the time to turn to God. God will run towards you when you take one step towards Him. You turn towards Him, He'll run to you. Anybody else that needs to give their life to Jesus Christ tonight and turn towards Him? All right, I'd like us all to stand in the presence of God. And I'd like about four or five people that raise their hands, I'm going to ask you to do something very bold. If you're serious about making a difference and making a change in your life and you want to see God help you, I'd like you just to step out of the aisles, into the aisles, and just come and meet me up here in front. And everybody else, you can just encourage them. But let's give the Lord a hand as these people come. And let's make and change some destinies here tonight. Just come from, step out of your, in the aisle, please, and just come and join us. Just come forward. For those that raise their hand, come and let's pray together. Come on. Come on. God bless you. Come and make a change. Turn to the light tonight. Turn to Jesus tonight. You may not have tomorrow. And Jesus went to a cross and He went. Anybody else? Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Tonight. Tonight's your night. Tonight's your night. Don't wait. Don't wait another day.
Jesus, I belong to you.
We're going to pray together. God bless you. Let's all agree. And there's some people that just need to pray where they are. Let's agree together. Because God's going to change your heart, even no matter where you are, even if you didn't have the courage to come forward. Let's pray together. Say, Dear Jesus, thank you that you love me. I believe that you're the Son of God. You came to this earth. You're born as a child. You grew up to be a man. You went to a cross. You died a horrible death for my sins, for my salvation. You tasted death for me. I believe you rose from the dead, that you're alive right now, and you're here in this place. I turn from sin. I turn from darkness. I turn my life to you. I ask you, Jesus, wash my heart with your precious blood. Come into my life. Be my Lord and be my Savior. Help me to serve you all the days of my life. I give my life to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's give the Lord a hand. Amen. Those other ones that raised your hand, didn't have enough courage, I do want you, right after the service, just to come out to the front here. If you just turn to my right and your left here, this is Pastor Joel. He just want to give you just a few things here. Let me shake your hand. God bless you, brother. Amen. Go ahead. You can just follow Pastor Joel.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son, and that you sent him for me, and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.